They're combing the streets. Searching house to house.
If they arrest you two, they will take you to their headquarters, and you will not return.
I'm more concerned with the 6-foot cat man who's got claws that can cut through vibranium alloy. By my count, that makes 2 super soldiers loose in Paris.
3, counting you.
And that's 2 too many.
I'll be there before the sun rises. Before the Germans, before that American. The Eye of Force has been found.
Please, just stick to the rooftops. Be careful. Stand was on me.
When am I not?
It's better if I tackle this one alone.
You may encounter some obstacles.
That won't be a problem. Our cat friend is definitely here too. By the look of things, he's not very far ahead.
The American boy is right on your heels.
Who the hell are you?
If you wanted us dead, we'd be dead. So what do you want?
Answers.
That's far enough!
Stay out of my way!
Stand aside!
I do not take orders from anyone!
I don't have time for this.
Neither do I.
Amazing. I just have to say, what we see up there is really next generation stuff. I don't know if you really realize, as I look at this, this is all real time, number one. Number two, I've heard through the grapevine that 20 to 30% of that is gameplay. So what we're dealing with here, I believe, is something that is really next level stuff. And I count myself as very fortunate to be able to moderate this panel. My name is Miles Perkins. I'm the Director of Client and Industry Relations in the M&E space. And I would like to introduce a wonderful panel. So please put your hands together for Marianne Hayden, Marco Brokvik, Chad Vernon, Dave Baldwin, Brian Karras. Yes, yes. So I want to start this off. I'm going to ask a few questions. And we're also going to, throughout this course, we're going to have a few explanatory comments that are going to happen where some of my colleagues from Epic Games are going to do a little bit of a deep dive. But I want to start with you, Marianne. The performances, oh my goodness, right? But I can just imagine that just even going into this project, I mean, how did you go? I mean, what were you expecting to be able to do here? Because it's really, I mean, I'm feeling like this is next generation stuff.
Oh, it totally is. And that is what we were expecting to do. Going into the project, it was, can we do this? And we've been able to capture the essence of our actors and their true performances using this tech from 3Lateral.
Yeah. I mean, that because there was a moment, I think, when Azuri, when he looks and he says, American, and he has this kind of, he scans him. And it's something that, to me, it comes out very clearly in his performance, but I don't think I would have gotten that necessarily from someone actually hand animating that.
Right. We're not splicing and dicing these performances. We're capturing them on the stage, and if we need another take, we'll do another take, but we're not going to ask an animator to create a different acting choice.
Right.
that has to come from our performers.
Right. And then also the other thing that I'm kind of curious about in this whole thing is, again, from that creative perspective and you guys coming into this, I mean, how did you, you know, you knew that you were going to use Unreal 5.4, or I think you maybe had an idea that you were going to be marching in that direction with us. But, you know, this bridging this gap between something that is really cinema, or meaning not cinematics, but film cinema and a game. I mean, how did you guys come into that? I could imagine the huddle where it's like, okay, guys, we're gonna do this together.
I mean, we're shooting it in similar ways that we've done games before. It is shot more like live action. Mm-hmm. And you know, we're not storyboarding. We're going to the stage and we're shooting. We're using a virtual camera on stage and looking at what our compositions can be, and then we're editing it later in post.
Right, right. Okay. Chad, I have to say that, you know, when you start to look at these things, I think about everything that you have to consider when you guys are going into this, in terms of, okay, this has to be able to be a game that can be played on such and such a device and all this. So there's a lot of considerations. And one of the things that I think about sometimes is, just because you can doesn't mean you should. Can you talk a little bit about that pipeline and how you guys approach this to be able to deliver something like this that is so kind of timely?
Yeah, I think it all comes down to what Amy mentioned this morning, how she's been sort of chasing this dream of having an interactive cinematic experience. And that's sort of how we approach sort of the three layers of how we approach all the content. Is you can make a cinematic image, but then how does it look when it moves? And you can make a cinematic video, but then how does it look when you're interacting with it and the player can do whatever it is a player wants to do? And it still has to look cinematic. And then you have to get it all running on an actual production machine that players are going to have. So I think it's a balance between all the tech that's been introduced this morning that allows us to sort of implement and deliver what Amy is looking for.
Yeah, and I mean, again, I noticed the visual vocabulary, right? We have a visual vocabulary that we're used to in film, right? And it's built. And it evolves over time. And it's these things where we know that, okay, when we get into an action scene, we have a certain expectation of what it's going to make us feel like. But again, it's always evolving. Same thing on the game side, though, right? And on a game, there's also a visual vocabulary and a kind of feel to everything. How are you dealing with that? Because again, this feels very different in how you're engaging with something that, like, I'm still having a hard time understanding what is gameplay and what is more of a cinematic here.
Yeah, I think that's sort of the goal. If we want to hear people say, oh, that looks good, but then if they say, oh, for a game, then we want people to say, that looks good, period. And we have heard people say, is that cinematics? Is that gameplay? And luckily, you know, as Miles said there, through the grapevine, like, probably, we'll see.
Cannot confirm or deny.
But I mean, it's just sort of like a, if we can balance of you're actually playing through this cinematic, but it's as much fun to play as it is for people to watch, then that's sort of the dream that we're chasing.
Yeah, I mean, I have had the honor of being able to see it quite a bit, and I'm not tired of it at all. I want more. So I think you guys have done a wonderful job there. And then the environment also, and Dave, I'll address this to you.
Yeah.
It's so rich and full of just, it feels like every nook and cranny you can get in there and do something. But
oh, yeah.
Stepping back, I mean, even what we saw here and we saw in the demo earlier today, there's so much there, but I just have this feeling that that's not it.
Oh, no. So to get the grounding and the reality of the cinematic feel that we're going for, we're actually going out and scanning, you know, big things as the size of mountains down to, like, things that are, like, you see on the desk. And so we're scanning those things because you get those little bits of detail that you can't get otherwise, or they're really hard to achieve when you're just hand modeling and sculpting and painting. So not to say that there's none of that going on, but it's, you know, definitely helps ground us in that world when you see those details that you that are really hard to like capture with traditional 3D kind of modeling techniques. So this is like, I mean, it's definitely new for me to being all going out and scanning stuff and bringing it back and then just seeing how well it just jives together and you're able to create these spaces that are just, they just feel more realistic and more believable. And it, you know, it shows, I think.
It shows, but then I'm also trying to figure out how all of that is going to fit into a package and run it real time.
That's a very good question, because that was one of the biggest things we ran into, where we started scanning these objects and we had, you know, desks, these French, beautiful French desks to fit in the space, but they were like huge on disk. And we're like, this, and this is a new thing for, you know, for me specifically, in the sense that I'm used to using, you know, polygons on screen was usually my bottleneck that I have to always adjust to on a constant basis. Now that's not so much a thing.
Right.
Now it's disk space.
Right.
So that's the next, that's the next thing. And I think definitely the stuff we've been working with Nanite and the new stuff you guys saw this morning, it's going to save our bacon.
Right.
When it comes to disk space.
Right. Yeah. And the other thing that I was kind of seeing in there, in that, you know, as we started to kind of layer upon layer, it felt like you have everything within your world and you're instancing things, right? So how are you able to do that efficiently? Because again, in a film environment, you don't have to be efficient, right? You don't, by any stretch of them, well, you got to get it to work one time so that it can print one frame and then you worry about the next frame, right? But here we are running at, you know, whatever you're going to run at on this game.
Yeah, we have to pay attention to what the player could potentially do. So they could, you know, looks in the direction we don't want them to. So the world space does still have to be 100%, you know, 360 degrees grounded in reality and looking good.
Right.
So that's one thing that sets us a little bit apart from, you know, film. In the
right.
sense that they have a shot, has to look really good. Right. Got to do 360 degrees looking really good.
Right. Well, okay. So the other part of this though is, I'm just thinking about as you're building these things, are you seeing them? Are you, I mean,
so,
because it's so complex until it's, you know, I think of music where people talk about, oh, let me put a little sprinkle here or a sprinkle there. It felt like you were putting little sprinkles here and there, but how do you do that without, are you seeing everything? Or
I mean, it's all in editor, so it's really easy to see all the you know, I call it cowbell, what we do, you know, because every level needs a little bit more cowbell.
Right.
So the idea is that, you know, bringing all these scans in, and then on top of that, Lumen, which is really awesome, because we don't have to, like, I can move a section of the level around. I don't have to wait for a rebake. I can actually just see it, the lighting, how the bounce light's going to work, and, you know, it's amazing in that sense, because it's like, it makes my life a lot easier, and it makes all the rest of the artists' lives a lot easier as well. One less thing they have to worry about.
It does help getting levels stood up quicker.
Yes.
A lot of times they'll put in the raw scan just to lay things out, see how it looks. We just have to make sure you have a good pipeline to not forget about it, because you want to capture, oh, there's a 30 million triangle cabinet sitting there.
We've done that a couple times. Yeah, where they've got, I mean, actually sometimes some of the scans we've get in, the raw scans, they work great at a distance. And we'll put them in the distance, and then, you know, Tobias, the art director, will come by and be like, oh, bring that forward. And we'll bring it forward, and he's like, that doesn't look good anymore. Put it back. It's like, yeah, it wasn't meant for that close, but that's okay, we'll get it there.
Right.
But yeah, it's you know, going from scan to actually putting it in engine, and the iteration time is so much faster now that we have accidents like that where we have these really good looking raw scan data, and it's, you know, easy to forget that's raw. It hasn't been, you know, finalized, hasn't been polished yet.
Right. It must be fun.
Oh, so much fun.
Well, with that, you know, one of the tools that you were able to kind of put your hands on was the nanite tessellation.
Yes.
And so this ability to really layer upon layer and create things, I don't want to say out of thin air, but just about out of thin air, real geometry.
It almost
geometry.
Feels like it, that's for sure. Because, you know, something I've always dreamed about is having, you know, a texture that generates the geometry on top of it. And now, I was, at the time, way back when, I was thinking, you know, just like plants and things like that. But this brings that to a whole nother level.
Right.
Where I can actually build a layered graph and build each piece on top of itself, and it flows, and actually the geometry works as you're building it up. So like the snow between boards on the planks on the bridge, now all of a sudden snow is going into the crack and actually fills it in. So it's not just like a texture on top. It's actually, there's not a gap anymore. It's filled with snow.
Right.
And it's not just about adding more detail, because I mean, Nanite, you know, can already handle millions and millions of triangles, and well, more triangles is always welcome. It's more, in my eyes, it's more about just iteration and workflow. So, for example, if you were there this morning, you saw some rocks that had snow on it. So the previous static workflow would be to take that out, model snow on top, put it back in. If you don't like it, go back and forth. And then if you want variations on that, you would still have to go back and forth. And now you have maybe three or four or a handful of copies of these rocks that are basically the same with just with various dirt or whatever on top. But with the tessellation workflow, you're basically just staying in editor and just editing materials with your one static mesh. So you're not, you know, bloating your disk space with multiple nanite meshes. It's all just in editor and in materials.
Well, we're lucky to have someone on the stage that seems to have dreamt up with this whole scheme. So Brian, I have to say pre-release of Nanite and Lumen, you were talking about thousands upon millions upon billions of triangles, and I do want that shirt, by the way. But I'm curious here, why do we need more triangles?
Yeah, so Nanite is really good at being able to draw tons of triangles, very tiny triangles, but as we're already kind of talking about, there are cases where that Nanite is capable of rendering smaller and more triangles than are necessarily there in the scene from that camera view at a time.
Right.
So I thought, well, I'll just make my own triangles. I'm going to make some more. So we added on this tessellation feature to be able to take a Nanite mesh and tessellate it further than what it's already at, to try to handle these cases like that, you know, being able to procedurally put on snow on top of sandbags,
right.
To be able to take lower poly or very high poly models, but when your camera gets close enough to it, those triangles eventually, you know, you run out of resolution at some point. And with the from what we were already talking about, that there's not a constrained camera. You can't just set up these scenes for exactly one particular view. You know, the player will be able to get closer to things and be able to see. And you don't want to have things, the resolution fall apart. But like kind of going into some of like how this is done to compare this to some features that
I'm going to tell people, this is going to be an explanatory comment here. So he's going to do a deep dive here. So hold on to your seats here. Take out the notepads.
So we've shipped in the past, this is back in 5.2, I believe. We shipped the feature, it's static displacement. So you can add on a displacement map in the Nanite properties for a static mesh. And it will take, in this case, this is a wall from Fortnite, what was originally a low poly wall mesh. And this wall was just like a flat plane. It was just a quad. And this, with the displacement map that was put on top of it, this feature will tessellate up, adaptively tessellate, and put the triangles where they need to be to turn it into a fully 3D mesh. But the downside there, like, it's really nice from a workflow point of view, but the downside is that you need to create and bake out this mesh of that wall plus this displacement map and that exact variation needs to be stored as a Nanite mesh out on disk. And every time that you're going to make a different variation, say you want that wall section with a different displacement map on it, you have to create a different Nanite mesh stored out to disk. And as you can see, like, it's putting the triangles where they need to be. But this is, these are some sort of like low frequency details. There's a lot of flat surfaces. But if you would get out to a surface like this that we're seeing in their game, the frequency of details here is just kind of extreme. If you would take this entire like ground section and just stored it as one big unique mesh with all of this pre-tessellated out, it would be just impractically large. So instead, we'll take the approach of dynamically tessellating it at runtime, that frame, for exactly that camera view, and putting the triangles where they need to be according to the camera. So what's actually happening here, what you see here, are, this is a coloration showing the patches. So these are the original triangles of the mesh, and then displaced. You can see the triangles aren't flat here. Now, normally, hardware tessellation that was introduced in like DirectX 11, we had support for this back in UE4. Like you guys may have already been familiar with a dynamic tessellation sort of feature. That might give you triangles down to this sort of scale. And even this, like in this example, the UE4 tessellation feature wouldn't be able to even get you this far because it kind of caps out in the sort of detail that you can get. But with nanite tessellation, we get down to this scale. We get down to triangles that are, they're only like 2 pixels big, each one of them. So this is, it's far more extreme in the sort of density than anyone's really has been doing for tessellation in real time. And it means that we can have these sort of really detailed displacement maps and get this sort of fidelity without seeing like weird morphing or any sort of like strange popping or crawling, because the detail is so small that you can't really see that. It's kind of following the same principle that nanite has been doing with its level of detail, where if the differences between any of these sort of changes are small enough, you just can't see it changing at all, so it looks completely stable. So how does that really work? What happens there was when we take one of those patches and we figure out how big it is, what sort of shape it is, and we pick from a library of pre-tessellated little meshes that we can replace that patch with. And which one we pick will be based on how long all of the three edges of that triangle patch is. So here's an example where we've got, over on the left-hand side, we've got an edge that's 4 long, another 4, and then 7 long. So it would pick that pattern to replace it with. And depending on what shape it is and how big it is, we can replace it with a little mesh. And then that will be displaced along the direction of the displacement map. But the problem comes is that we can't store out every single sized triangle going up to monstrously big. So what happens then? What happens when we run out of these little pre-tessellated patterns? So we'll just take one of these and zoom in on it. And this is the sort of case that you get where it's just we don't have of a pre-tessellated patch that can cover something that's this big. So we solve it recursively. We'll take it, and then we'll take one of the triangles of this mesh and replace it with another one, and replace it with another one, so on, recursively, until we get down to triangles that are as big as we want them to be. And what you're seeing here in this demo was down to triangles that are approximately 2 pixels big. That's something that you can set, but at that sort of level, we can hit the sort of performance that we're looking for, as well as the quality bar. Last thing I want to touch on is something that we've kind of hinted at, which is the sort of space savings that you can get just compared to the typical nanite mesh. So on the left side here, we've got a nanite mesh that's 3 million triangles. This is like a Quixel Megascans rock. At 3 million triangles, we've got a lower poly version of the same rock that's only 24,000 triangles. And we can apply a displacement map to it, use this dynamic tessellation feature and displace it. And for this for essentially the same sort of visual fidelity, you can get like a over 6 times compression. I should note that it's not necessarily going to be completely equivalent in terms of performance. Nanite is very fast and is highly efficient at what it does. So this new tessellation feature comes with a bit of cost, but it also comes with a lot of other improvements in the form of disk size savings and flexibility to do things that you simply couldn't do. So it's another tool in your toolbox. to be able to approach problems where in, you know, in some cases you might want to do the left hand side, in some cases you might want to do the right hand side, in some cases you have something that you couldn't even have a choice there because you simply couldn't do it without this new tessellation feature.
That's really cool. Yeah. I actually want to add on to that a little bit, is that, yeah, we're already essentially baking out our height maps when we're using them to do the blending of the material work. So we're already paying for that, essentially. And now we can do it on our one-to-one models, like that really fancy, you know, French table that I was talking about. We can now take that model, reduce the polygon count, use the height map that we already have for it, and make it look even better than it did when it was just the regular nanite and it was already too heavy, which is awesome. So I'm very excited about this tech.
Good thing to mention is not just the compressed package size, it's like the actual art file size that you're working with, just sort of like the raw, whether it's an OBJ, if anyone's using that, or the FBX, or the Maya file, or the ZBrush file. Like when things are millions and millions of triangles, it just slows down iteration speed with artist speed, with iterations, trying to open up the file, import it back in. But so if you're just working with lower res geometry, it's just like everybody's lives is just easier.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. There's been many a times where I've had to open a model that was, you know, for the original nanite stuff and had to like make a change and it's like click. Okay, there it is. Yeah. So
right. We can make Unreal render this stuff faster and handle this higher detail, but we can't make every other application run faster too, necessarily.
Well, I mean, I have to say in that context, though, again, going back to seeing how fast things are changing and how fast that this is just becoming a technology that just is and getting better, and these edge cases that you're talking about, starting to identify those and solve those problems. I mean, just kudos to the team and the creative forces behind pushing this. So, I mean, I think it's pretty amazing to see us start to solve some of these things. So, and to that point, what we also saw earlier was the volumetric. So the heterogeneous volumetrics, which, I mean, just looking at that and starting to look at the details that you have in there, and again, you know, understanding that, as Kim said earlier, what did he say? It looks nice from afar, but far from nice.
Yep.
And I think that's really the case in this. But Dave, can you talk a little bit about being able to add things like this into the environments that you're creating?
Oh, yeah. I mean, preaching to the choir here, but that's a huge win. Essentially, you know, the VFX, you know, industry as a whole, when it comes to video games, one of the biggest requested things is taking, you know, 2D sprites and trying to make them into 3D volumetric looking things. And that, you know, it can hold up for the most part. And, you know, we will still actually be using it, like, you know, like you said at the very beginning, you know, you don't want to use your, just because you can use something doesn't mean you should use it.
Right.
But where it matters, this is going to be, you know, this is essentially what we're going to be leaning on. And it's great because the, you know, you can take the VDB files, bring them in, put them into the sparse texture file format, bring them into the this volumetric system, and it just works. And it looks gorgeous.
Right.
And it's just, and it gives us that next level of believability that's really hard to capture, you know, with traditional methods. So this is like, we're going to be using it probably as much as we can within reason, of course.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's going to be amazing.
Well, I always also saw, you know, like matte paintings that are in film, right? They would always, like, in order to kind of trick the eye to make you really believe something is believable, you put a little bit of smoke or a little bit of something that is the little bit of movement that is giving your brain the ability to go, okay, yeah, well, that's plausible.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that's what VFX do to the environments is they breathe that life into it.
Right.
And when you have something as realistic and, you know, just it's showing the volumetrics of the smoke itself and the fires and, you know, that makes that space more believable. And it's one of those things where, like, if you think about it, in video games, the better looking the art is, the less you pay attention to it.
Right.
The less you, you know, you, if there's something wrong, it might be something you don't necessarily know what it is.
Right.
Yeah. And on that point, the volumetrics is adding to the scene, but it's also about the scene applying and integrating well with the volumetrics.
Yes.
So like
right.
for it to sit there in the scene and not stand out, it needs to get
the lighting.
It needs to have lighting applied to it. It needs to be able to pick up, have shadows be able to cast onto it, for it to be able to cast shadows onto itself, for it to be able to cast shadows onto the world, for it to composite correctly with those other sort of particle effects where you still have sort of traditional sprite-based particles. You need to have that like sort and integrate properly, integrate with other volumetric like fog that might be in the scene. So that's a bunch of the work that that the Unreal team has been working on to get this to really look this good.
Yeah.
I will say though, just to be totally honest, this is early days for the volumetric feature. This is something that we first approached from the sort of virtual production and film use cases, and we've been trying to like see how we can get that into real time and like game contexts. And seeing this for the first time in these sort of use cases is really exciting. Yeah. And we'll just have to see like where that can be used, and just from the not from the like breaking point of view, but from the performance point of view, like where can it fit into budgets without breaking the bank?
I think that's also an important theme, I think, for everyone to understand in the context of looking at the tool set, is that understanding that there is an experimental phase, and then there's something that is more kind of something that is a little bit more of a service, like you're really going to have to give your developers get in there and really work with it to make it work. And then it turns into a product that you just take for granted. And we're going to talk about that a little bit more in a moment, but it's one thing that I notice is a theme. And it's also something that people, I think, developers can expect, right? And if you're brave enough to jump in there on the ground floor, amazing things will happen, especially as we start to get feedback, like we're getting feedback from you guys. So I mean, just thank you guys for being brave enough to jump in with both ears.
Yeah, living on the edge, man. It's fun.
Yeah. So with that, I want to kind of transition to the next part, which is just, okay, I had an awkward moment because we had the actors that were sitting here, and I just felt like I knew him intimately because you could look at his face and the pores on his face. And I'm just like, yeah, it was an awkward moment for me. But why is that so fantastic? Like I'm having a hard time really understanding that this is a game. And to be honest with you, it looks better than a lot of the digital humans I see out there in other stories. So can you tell me a little bit about the process that you have? Who'd you work with? How did it go down? And is it a lot more or like, yeah, what went into it?
So we worked with 3Lateral and we spent a lot of time on the beginning side of it and our scanning, making sure that we captured not only like their true essence in like what their digital look will be, but making sure that when we did our captures, their performances, their characters were coming through, not just so that we can replicate like exactly what they look like. Their faces need to be able to move the way they're going to move their faces when we go and we shoot something. So for example, we use, when we're scanning, we use panograms. And these are like nonsensical sentences that put a bunch of words together that once they're in this sentence, it moves all the muscles in the face so that we get every single combination possible. So like one is the hungry purple dinosaur ate the kind zingy fox, the jabbering crab, the mad whale, and started bending and quacking. It's like, right? And so we ask our actors to say these sentences in like 6 different emotions. Mm-hmm. So you say it really happy, you say it really sad, you say it neutral, and we have them do it in character. And if they have an accent, also in that accent, because different accents will put sounds and move your face in a different way. And we need, in those scannings, we need to make sure we cover all of that.
I mean, and so when you go through all that, but you also went through all the performances as well. In past, I'm aware of just trying to create a couple, 30 seconds, a minute of that kind of performance is going to take a good amount of time for a team to do, but that was a lot of animation that was up there, and I'm imagining that in the game, there's way, way more.
We're going to have hours of it.
Right. And yeah. So, like, how long is it taking the team in order to deal with any one of these captures? Or
so the trailer that you saw, and then if you were here earlier this morning, we had an extensive scene on the bridge with Captain America and Black Panther. If you take those two combined, we have about 83 seconds of facial animation. A few years ago, that would have taken, you know, a handful of animators, probably 3 to 5 weeks of facial polish. We only spent 5 days of facial animation polish on that. Wow. Both of those.
That's amazing. That's phenomenal. Because, I mean, like I said, the performances were spectacular.
And Amy mentioned this too this morning. The Black Panther scene on the bridge, no animators did any adjustments to his face. That's pure capture.
Yeah.
We didn't need to go in and push any of his like smiles or smirks or add a blink. And if you add a blink, it's not going to seem natural.
Right.
It needs to come from the performance.
Right.
And that's just testament to the tech.
Yeah, I think a lot of that is just major props to Marco and his team is just delivering that rig. It's almost, you know, drag and drop into the project. You know, we got the rig. As soon as we put animation on it, you know, we see it and we're like, oh, well, I guess we're done. you know, I've worked on sort of performance capture movies in the past, and I'm just used to, you know, you get the rig, maybe you're in something like Maya, you're working in something gray shaded or diffuse shading, and it takes weeks to animate it, and then you finally see a render, maybe a few weeks after that, and you're like, all right, well, there's what it looks like now, and now we need to tweak some things. But this one was just like, oh, I guess we could just see it fully rendered and animated, and we don't have to do much.
We're a really small team, too. So if we have to spend a lot of time polishing all of the facial animation, like, we'll never finish this game.
Right.
So having that ability, we can focus on making our heroes seem like supers because, you know, Captain America and Black Panther, we were going to need to adjust other animation, you know, their body animation.
Right.
And then we can let their performances just come through on the captures that we get on stage.
I'm struck again by the scale. You know, I mean, that's one thing that I feel like we're starting to see with some of the tools, whether that's software, hardware, whatever it is, that we're starting to get to a point where that technology that supports the art is really supporting the art. And I'm not just talking about you guys, I'm also talking about the actors, right? Carrie and Drew, also, that this technology is supporting them in a lot, because I mean, realistically, there've been other things that I've seen where an actor has done something that translates over to a digital character. And if the animator had done that thing, they probably would have been fired because it was just such a weird thing that they did. But the actor, being that they authored it, everything that comes after that movement, you know, again, I spoke before about how he very quickly looked Drew up and down when he said, you know, American hero, and he looked at him and it was just like, I mean, that you get from a person who is really, really good at their craft. And so, I mean, I don't know what you think about that and how that, because again, going back to the first question, coming into this process, I think in the past, we just think, oh, I'll fix it in post, I'll fix it later in dev, I'll fix it. But you guys didn't take that approach.
No, I mean, we're a story-driven game, right? And so we want our story to be told with our heroes. And if we don't get the performance that we want on stage, we're not going to ask an animator to create a different acting choice. Right. Well, if we need to, go back to the stage and recapture it.
Right.
It needs to come from our actors and the direction that Amy is giving them.
I will say, though, that that is also a testament to a really great team that can have a plan and execute on a plan, because that's not always the case. So, I mean, there is also, again, taking my hat off to you guys also, it really isn't always the case. A lot of people want to rely on the technology to deliver, but you guys came in with a plan and you've been really true to it. So, Marco, we've been talking a lot about all of this, and we've seen our metahumans step onto the scene. We've seen them, we are even seeing them now in UEFN, which is crazy to me to think about that. But how did you make this look so good?
Yeah, well, it's not just about making it look good, so like pushing the quality bar. It's also about making it accessible to people and everyone, so pushing that bar of how easy it is to get results, right? And like what Marianne was saying about making sure that the performers have the ability to, you know, really have their performance translate, it's about sort of removing the technical obstacle and just letting the art happen, basically.
Right.
And I think we have this sort of mentality of feeding back what we find and what we do and what we do with our partners into our process and making sure it gets better and better and better. So like Marianne was saying about how it's very important to have these pangrams and things, and we also like to capture a little bit of their performance as well. So you really capture their, the essence of how, like everyone has their quirks and you know, they move their face in a certain way, and like you want to capture that right at the very beginning. You don't want to start thinking about that at the end of the pipeline. You want to do it at the beginning so that it all translates throughout the whole pipeline. So we capture a lot of data to make this possible, and then we do a lot of R&D to create these tools, and then we start using these tools. And that's like the three lateral services, basically the arm of the MetaHuman team that tests our tech, right? It makes sure it's robust. We do our demos. You know, we had the Blue Dot demo last year, and like we learn, and then it goes back, and then we develop, and then when it's ready, we partner with amazing like artists. And I absolutely agree that when you put it into the hands of other people and artists, like they do things which we didn't expect, like and then like we, oh, all right, so that's a challenge we need to deal
right.
with, and then it goes back again. It can even change the type of data we want to acquire, and then it goes through the R&D again, create more tools, and then
so again, that's that kind of R&D, and then there's the kind of services where you're working really working out all of the details, and then it shows up kind of in the product.
And in the end,
right.
It goes into the product, and hopefully like the public gets a chance to have a whack at it. And then they do things with it, which are amazing. And like, okay, what about these use cases? Which is really, really amazing. You guys used the ML rig, right? Which is like the highest fidelity, like high-end asset.
But thank you.
Yeah. But then there's like UEFN, where we have lowered that bar so that everyone can use these rigs. And the underlying tech, you can use MetaHuman Animator with those. So it's not about just pushing the quality. It's about, you know, making sure that we democratize the tech and everything.
So before you get into your explanatory comment, which you're about to dip into, I mean, and maybe this is going to be a part of that, but this idea that you just had is that kind of the MetaHuman 1, the 12, the 15, and the 4D, that's kind of what you're talking about here, right?
Yeah.
That level of fidelity that you're putting into the model and that is then coming out of the backside, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So like basically, if you look at the like our history, you can see like what we went through and like the evolution of the MetaHumans. And as time goes by, we basically try to make available what was cutting edge. And like we try to make it as easy as possible for people to use. We try to get it in the hands of like the public and our partners, and then we see what they really want. Right. We learn from that and then push in that direction, because the space is infinite. Like, you could develop in all sorts of directions, but you want to like see what people are actually doing and try to, you know, push that way because you have limited resources. So, for instance, if you look at the MetaHuman Creator, you're just using like your artistic eye, and everyone can do that, open up the MetaHuman Creator and create a rig, which is like, you use a reference basically, but then you can use Mesh to MetaHuman, which uses one scan, and you're basically now calibrating the rig, right? And you have that neutral scan, which you have the fidelity of the person in your rig, but when the actor starts acting, or you start acting, you might get, you know, a smile which isn't exactly your smile, maybe your jaw open isn't quite as wide as the rig you get. And then you can start going even further by adding more scans. And this is like what we were talking about, MH1, MH12, MH50. Basically adding more scans, adding more data into the rig will calibrate it further and capture more of the person and make sure that like it's truer to whatever you're doing. Right now it has your smile, now it has that wink you do, right? And then you can use 50 scans. That's like covering most of what your face is going to do. And then you can have 50,000 scans, which is basically the 4D, and that's the ML rig. And with the ML rig, it's not just about capturing the expressions, then it becomes about capturing those nuances of the performance, right? Because at that point, you're getting those ticks, you're getting those like subtleties, which you, like you said, like him looking up and down, you might not get those kind of details right. with just 50 or 70 or 100 scans. But like, and that, like processing 50,000 scans is not easy. And like, it's not something you could go through and sculpt and do. But like, we have now developed tools where you can actually capture that data and actually use it, and it's implemented. And what's amazing, like right now the public has access to MetaHuman Creator, Mesh to MetaHuman. What's amazing is that we've started seeing people actually calibrate those rigs further, use more scans themselves, you know, take those MetaHumans, edit them. We've even seen, I've seen, just browsing through the internet, like someone trying to do 4D as well, which is super cool. These are the things that basically enable us to, going back to, you know, Skydance, have the artists only think about what they want to do, and it just gets translated to the screen with MetaHuman Animator.
Yeah.
And everything.
So in terms of bringing that into the game, again, this is, I'm imagining that it's very dense, right? And again, you have to consider, I have to run this at perf. I need to make sure that it's fitting. It's the disk and all of that. How is that working out?
I mean, it's basically pretty similar to a MetaHuman rig. At the end of the day, the animation interface is the same. So if you really wanted to, you could copy that animation, put it on any MetaHuman. It would do the same performance for that MetaHuman. And like all MetaHumans, there's just a series of LODs. And you know, when you're really up close, you're LOD zero. And when you're far away or in gameplay, you're, you know, increasing the LOD. But just, you know, it holds up. I think, we haven't had to do anything special to get it up to perf. It's just sort of out of the box what it is.
Marianne, I heard through the grapevine that you might have got a little thing, a little performance in there with one of the is that right?
Yeah. with the iPhone, I captured a brief performance of, in the trailer, there's a soldier whose head gets smashed onto a typewriter. That's me.
That is really awesome.
And isn't that awesome? Like, they're having fun while working on these
right.
things. Like, that's amazing to me.
Right. I mean, I'm always in awe of the gamification of
game development.
Yeah.
So that's kind of pretty cool as well.
The turnaround speed, you know, Marianne would be on a video call and she'd be like, hey, watch this. And she'd take a minute, just record herself, and then import it into the game. And 30 seconds later,
it's
like,
so fast.
It's crazy. So fast.
Yeah.
And it's so easy.
Yeah. I like to say, like, a Datsun 210 that you used to have a long time ago, you really had to drive it, right? And now you have these Porsche or something else. And I don't think that the drivers don't have to be as good as the driver of the Datsun 210. And I'm feeling, and it's not that people aren't as good, it's that they can be so much better. And the scale at which you can do things, I mean, that's kind of what you're saying. It's like you're able to get, I mean, animators are actors, right? You're getting that across, and it's, I don't know, it's just amazing to see all of this starting to come together. So there aren't the creative blockers, right?
It's not just the speed of iteration, just also the quality. Like out of the box, you know, we've seen facial solves in the past where you get the puppet kind of mouth, but, you know, capturing what we've seen in MHA, you know, you're seeing all the lips roll, and the quality is just a lot better than what it used to be.
Right.
In the past.
Right.
But also, we will not, as animators, capture performance and put it on our Captain
right,
America.
Right, no, yeah.
It
of
won't
course.
Work.
Of course.
It won't look like him. It yeah. has to be him. It's just yeah. like we're never going to create a different performance that he
right.
didn't do.
Yeah.
I think that's an important point, because even if you wanted to, you couldn't. Because, like, the fact that they were the ones that captured all of this training data, only they will drive that rig the way it like to give you that highest fidelity, right?
Right.
It's not like you now have their special sauce and you can do with it whatever you want and just generate performances. No. That rig is linked with that person. Like you can't have one without the other. And only if that person is the one doing that little, you know, look up and down, or like, you know, it's like similar with the table, like those little details. That's right. The only thing that's going to trigger those little details and all of that.
Yeah.
So it's very, and it's important for us, like none of that is getting, like the data, it's not going to MetaHuman Creator or anything, like nothing gets stored. It's just like specially created for the performer themselves.
Yeah, I really appreciate that, because again, there's nothing like, I mean, there's nothing like a performance driven by a just top-notch actor. Like, that is a craft that people study for their life.
Yeah.
The same as, you know, building an environment. It's something that whether you're, you know, a caveman on a wall or you're in there with UE and you're building everything, it's still that vision that
yep.
you have that
okay.
is actually driving things. And the other thing that I'm impressed with is that the vision evolves, and that's who we are as human beings. Our vision consistently evolves. So,
I did want to ask one yes. question to Marianne. Well, the first one we brought into the engine was Gabe, right? In the trailer, that one performance, because I remember it was
right.
shocking.
Right.
When we very first previewed it, the amount of detail on his face and the way he expressed himself, I think my jaw just hit the floor. I was like, oh my God, this is like, at that point I knew we were at, like,
when he was against
amazing.
The board.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's like, I was like, we're onto something.
Yeah. That little twitch
yeah.
that he had. Yeah.
Oh my God.
His face moves in like the most awesome
it's
ways.
So,
too.
Yeah. It's so cool to see that.
He talks kind
yeah.
of like on the side of his mouth
right.
a lot, and he's got so much volume in his cheeks, and the fact that we can see all of that.
Yeah.
It's really cool.
Yeah. yeah.
It's epic.
Hey.
Sorry. I had to.
Well, there's nothing to a performance without, we want to make sure that our uniform is appropriate. So this also is amazing. So let's talk a little bit about the ML deformers that are here. So machine learning, being able to take in data sets and then bring them back and run in real time. Bonkers.
just absolutely bonkers. But maybe you can talk to me a little bit about what that process is. When do you use it? When do you not use it? Because there's, of course, the cloth physics in the engine. But can you tell me a little bit about that?
Yeah, so basically we use the ML deformer you can see on Cap's costume. So there's sort of different cloth strategies. For example, the cape on Black Panther was traditional chaos cloth. But for something that's somewhat form-fitting and you want to see wrinkles on it, the ML deformer stack is really what you want to use. So basically how we approach this is we take a lot of the workflows used in film, creating a cloth simulation rig. We set that up in Houdini in this case. I believe you could do it in Engine now. But outside of while you're in Houdini or whatever, you can do whatever you want with that simulation setup, whether it's leather, silk, or cloth. Then you pipe it through a training set based off of your animation that's in game. It's up to you how much or how little you want to train it. Ideally, you want to have enough coverage to cover the space that your character is going to move in. And then it's sort of a back and forth iteration. The system trains what it sees. You put in a pair of FBXs, which is just skinned, and some simulated alembics. And then Unreal can train how to recreate those wrinkles based off of the pose of the body. So you can throw, once you have your data set trained, then you throw in, you know, almost arbitrary animation, and it'll recreate those wrinkles during a runtime. So it's actually pretty amazing.
It's super amazing. I mean, this means that, like, from the character side of things, you don't have to model in all those wrinkles. You can let them be, you know, actually look like the proper wrinkles and actually animate.
It gets rid of the baked wrinkle look and sort of the stiff video game look that you might see in sleeves or
so they don't have to look like little figurines or
They don't have to look action figures anymore. Yeah, and you don't have to do like the normal tricks and things like that anymore as well. It's like it's there. It's awesome.
And the other thing that I think about this is seeing this. So you, what I'm getting from this is you don't use this everywhere, right? You use this right now for this. Part of it, what has been released, you've used with Cap, but you use other things in other spaces, yeah?
Yeah, I mean, we only have Cap right now just because it's early in our development, but I mean, we plan on having more. There's nothing really, I mean, performance-wise, it's actually extremely fast. So we would expect to see this, not just in cinematics.
Well, I think we are about to come up on the hour, and I would like to thank all of you for being up here. I have to say, I want to hit, you know how in Assassin's Creed, you sit down and you say, pass time. I'm ready to sit down and pass time till I can get my hands on this game. So thank you so much, and we will be watching you guys and want to wish you the best as you do this, because I think you guys are going to change the game of games. So thank you.